Dear learners, welcome to the NIS course on Introduction to Law at Senior Secondary level. I am Dr. Vikesram Tripathi, teaching in Faculty of Law, University of Delhi. Today we will discuss personal laws first, that is Hindu and Muslim law. Learning outcome of this presentation will be the meaning of personal law along with the sources of Hindu and Muslim laws, concept of marriage and divorce among the Hindus and Muslim, rules relating to succession and devolution of property amongst the Hindus, rules relating to inheritance and devolution of property amongst the Muslims. So, let us discuss the meaning of personal law along with the sources of Hindu and Muslim laws, concept of marriage and divorce amongst the Hindus and Muslims, rules relating to succession and devolution of property amongst the Hindus, rules relating to inheritance and devolution of property amongst Muslims. Friends, the people of India belongs to different religions and faiths, and that is why we are governed by different set of personal laws in respect of matters relating to family affairs, that is marriage, divorce and succession. Hindus are being governed by their own personal laws, Hindu personal laws, so therefore Hindu personal laws are applicable to them. Muslims are governed by the Muslim personal laws, Christians are governed by the Christian personal laws, and Parsis are governed by the Parsi personal laws. Now let us discuss who is an Hindu. So friends, a Hindu is any person who is a Hindu, Jain, Sikh or Buddhist by religion. That is all the persons, those they are Hindu by religion. Now second category is any person who is born of Hindu parents, either when both the parents are Hindus or only one of the parents is Hindu, that is Hindu by birth. Now the second category is any person who is not a Muslim, Christian, Parsi or Jew, and who is not governed by any other laws, meaning thereby the residuary category. So, if you are not belongs from any particular region, you will be belong from a Hindu in India. Now, let us discuss the sources of Hindu law. So, the sources can be divided further into two categories, ancient sources and modern sources. The ancient sources of Hindu laws are Vedas or Shruti. Shruti means something which has been learned from hearing, which has been heard. Then Smritis, which can be which is remembered, so by memory, Smritis, we have Manu Smriti, we have the other Smritis also. Then again, certain commentaries and digest written by the scholars of the fields over the topic. And then the next category is, the next source is this customs and usages, the prevalent practices into the society. Now coming to the modern sources, the first category is the equity, justice and good conscience principles, the principles that are being followed by the courts over the period of time. Now, the specific judicial decisions over the specific issues related with the Hindus laws. And then the last category is the legislation. So, we have Hindu Marriage Act 1955, we have Hindu Guardianship and Minority Act, we have Hindu Maintenance and Adoption Acts. So, these are the legislations or the modern sources of Hindu laws. Now, friends, let us discuss about the Muslim personal laws, and to begin with, who is a Muslim? Friends, a Muslim is a person who practices Islam religion. As per the judicial opinion, a person may be Muslim either by birth or through the conversion. A Muslim is a Muslim by birth when both the parents were Muslim at the time of his birth. A Muslim is a Muslim by conversion when a person of different religion, on attaining the age of majority and acting with the full consciousness, renounces his religion and converts into a Muslim. Now, after this, friends, let us discuss what are the sources of the Muslim law. Again, like the Hindu law, we can divide the sources of Muslim law into the two categories, that is ancient sources and modern sources. See, the first ancient source is nothing else but the Holy Quran itself, the pious book of Islam religion. So, whatever has been said by the Prophet Muhammad, these are considered to be the basic principles governing the Muslims. Then next category is the Sunnat or Hadith. So, all the Sunnats that are being followed by the Prophet Muhammad Sahab, that is the practices that has been followed by him, are considered to be the another important source of Muslim law. Now, the third category is the Ijma. Friends, when over a particular issue there is an absence of any guiding principles either by the Holy Quran or by the Sunnat or Hadith, then the issue is being debated among the scholars of the Muslim religion, and then they reach to a consensus over the problem, and that consensus is called ijma. Now, the next category is the qiyas. Qiyas means to drawing an analogy over a for a particular problem. So, by drawing an analogy from a different sources, we reach to a solution. So, that is called qiyas. And now, the last category of ancient source are the custom, means the practices that are being followed over a period of time by the people or the usages. Now, coming to the modern sources, friends, the legislation is the first modern source. We have the Shariat Act 1937, we have the Act Dissolution of Marriage Act 1939, then again we have the Muslim Women Protection on Right to Divorce Act 1986. So, these are the some legislations. Then again, the next category of modern source is the judicial decisions, and of course, like the Hindu laws, the principles of justice, equity and good conscience are the another important modern source of Muslim laws. Let us discuss the marriage under the Hindu laws. Friends, marriage under the Hindu religions are considered to be the more sacramental rather than simply legalizing the sexual intercourse between the two opposite sex or to legalizing the procreation of child. Something more than that, that is more of the sacramental value. So, let us discuss, friends, what are the essential conditions of marriage under the Hindu laws. The first and foremost condition is that the marriage must be a monogamous marriage. So, meaning thereby it should not be a bigamous marriage, meaning thereby the parties of the marriage should not have already been married. If it is a husband not having already a wife, or if it is a wife not having already a husband. So, it must be a monogamous marriage. Now, the second category is, friends, the conditions regarding the mental health or capacity. Both the parties to the marriage, they must be able to be give a valid consent. And not only a valid consent, they may be able to be give a valid consent, but they may not be capable of procreating the child, or they may not be fit for the marriage, or they may be suffering from a virulent form of leprosy or for any other diseases. So, these persons are not qualified, meaning thereby the parties to the marriage must be in a good mental health and in mental capacity and to capable of giving a valid consent. Now, the next important condition is the condition of marriageable age. So, as per the Hindu laws, Hindu Marriage Act, the age for the bridegroom is 21 years and for the bride is 18 years. So, the bride must be of the age of 21 years and the bridegroom must be of the age of 21 years. And if any marriage between the parties below the age of bride 18 years or the bridegroom below the age of 21 years will be considered to be a child marriage and which will be considered legally void. Now, the next important condition is the marriage must not be between the persons coming under the degree of prohibited relationship. So, the degree of prohibited relationship means the neither of the parties should be related with the another party of the marriage by way of lineal ascendant of any of the relative of the other parties. Now, meaning thereby if someone will not be allowed to be married with his daughter of his own uncle or a daughter of his own sisters. Now, the next important conditions of a Hindu marriage is the sapenta relationship. So, parties must not be come into the sapenta relationship. Sapenta means from the same pint. So, both the parties, the bride and bridegroom, they both not should be come from a sapenta relationship. Sapenta relationship legally means the 5 degree of lineal ascendant through the father and 3 degree of lineal ascendant through the mother. So, Marriage is basically a rule under Hindu law, friends, but because of certain reasons, the parties may not be happy with each other. So, therefore, divorce as an exception is the rules which prescribes to be coming out of the pious bond of the marriage. So, under Hindu law, parties to the marriage means the wife and husband, they can take the divorce on the following grounds. Few grounds are only available to the husband only, few grounds are only available to the wife only, and few are the grounds which are available to be both. First is the adultery, meaning thereby the husband must not, or any of the party, either the husband or wife, must not having a sexual relationship with the any other person out of the wedlock, meaning thereby the husband must not have a sexual relation with anybody else than the wife. If the husband does so, it's also punishable under the criminal laws, as well as it's a good ground for the seeking divorce by the wife. Now, the second category is the cruelty. Friends, cruelty may be the physical cruelty or a mental cruelty. So, any kind of mental torture or the physical torture by any of the parties, by the wife to the husband or by the husband to the wife, is a common ground for divorce for both of them. Now, the third ground is the desertion. So, if the husband has deserted the wife for a considerable period of time, that is for 2 years or more than 2 years, then it can be a ground for the divorce. Now, the another important ground is the conversion. So, if any of the party to the marriage has converted his religion, that is from Hindu he has opted any other religion, it will be a ground for the opposite party for a divorce. Now, if any of the parties which suffer from a virulent form of leprosy or disease, it will be a ground for divorce under the Hindu laws. Now, the next category is a ground for the divorce is the venereal diseases. So, if the party to the marriage, either the bride or bridegroom, is suffering with any kind of venereal disease, then the other party can seek a divorce on this ground. Now, the next ground is presumption of a death. So, and that is the presumption is of the 7 years. If the, within the 7 years, there is no knowledge of whereabout of the husband, then the wife, or as the case may be the husband, if there is no knowledge of whereabout of the wife, the parties can seek a divorce on this ground. Now, the another ground is renunciation of the word. So, if the any of the party has renounced the word for whatever reasons, the other party can claim a divorce on this ground. Now, the next important ground is this divorce by mutual consent. So, if both the parties are by mutual consent, they are agreed that not to be live together, they by filing a petition, they can separate their to each other, and by this the marriage is dissolved. Now, the next important ground is irrevocable breakdown of a marriage. So, if the parties are living separately by the court orders for almost more than 1 year, they are living separately, that is called judicial separation. So, on this ground, the another party or any of the party to the marriage can seek the divorce, that is called the divorce on the ground of irretrievable breakdown of marriage. Friends, after discussing the marriage and divorce under Hindu law, now let us discuss the marriage and divorce under Muslim law. So, marriage under Muslim law. Friends, unlike the Hindu's law, marriage under Muslim law is less of a sacramental importance, but more of legitimizing the children's as well as legitimizing the sexual intercourse between two opposite sex. Friends, the followings are the essentials for a valid Hindu marriage. And first is, the parties must be in a capacity to marry. Friends, here capacity to marry means the parties must be of sound mind and they must be of age of puberty. So, here age of puberty means generally the age of 15 years. Unlike the Hindu laws, where the requirement is of 18 years and 21 years respectively for the bride and bridegroom, here it is a age of puberty, that is 15 years for the parties to the marriage under Muslim law. Now, second essential elements are that there must be a clear proposal and acceptance in presence of two male witnesses. Friends, that is called ijab and kabul. So, there must be a clear cut proposal from a one side, and then there must be an acceptance from the other side, and that too in the presence of two male witnesses. Friends, it is relevant to mention here that under Muslim law there are two important sects, Shia and Sunni. So, this requirement of two male witnesses are not essential in case of Shia marriage. Now, friends, the another essential of a valid Muslim marriage is the free consent of the parties. So, the parties must be given their free consent for the marriage, meaning thereby the consent must not be given into any undue pressure or any because of any fraud or for any other reasons. So, the consent must be freely given. There is one practice that even a consent can be also given on behalf of the parties by their guardians, meaning thereby the father or a grandfather in certain circumstances. Now, the next important condition for the valid Hindu marriage is that no legal disability between the parties, meaning thereby the parties must not be in such an relationship that they cannot marry, meaning thereby they must not be in a relationship which is prohibited under the Muslim law for the marriage. Now, the next important category is the formalities. See, friends, neither the writing formalities are there nor any specific religious ceremony is required. The marriage is generally solemnized in the presence of a qazi by offer of the one party, that is called ijab, and by the acceptance of the other party, that is called kubur. These are the formalities of Muslim marriage. Now, friends, the last essential is that there must be a consideration in terms of a dower, what is called mehar. Friends, unlike the Hindu's law, here the dower comes from the side of bridegroom rather than from the bride. So, it is the bridegroom who gives the fixes the particular amount, that is called mahar, at the time of marriage for the bride. So, now friends, after looking into the marriage laws of Muslims, let us see the divorce under Muslim law. So, like the Hindu law, friends, divorce is also one of the exceptional circumstances into the Muslim law, and rule is the marriage. Friends, here we need to distinguish between two things, the dissolution of marriage and the divorce. The marriage can be dissolved by any other means. Divorce is one of the method to dissolve the marriage. So, friends, the marriage can be dissolved under Muslim law either by the act of the God, that is by death of any of the parties to the marriage, or by the act of the parties, that is called divorce. So, a divorce under Muslim law further can be either the extrajudicial divorce or the judicial divorce. That is why extrajudicial divorce can be further classified into three categories. That is extrajudicial divorce by husband, extrajudicial divorce by wife, extrajudicial divorce by mutual agreement of husband and wife both. So, friends, first we will see the divorce by the husband. So, friends, husband can take the three kinds of divorce. First is known as talaq, second is known as ila, and third is known as jihr. Friends, talaq, which is further can be classified into two categories, talaqul sunnat and talaqul biddat. Talaqul sunnat means a talaq which has been pronounced and within a particular period of time it can be revoked. However, talaqul ban, popularly which is known as triple talaq, once a triple talaq has been pronounced, it is irrevocable, meaning thereby once the husband pronounced the triple talaq, he cannot revoke this talaq. Now, the second kind of talaq which can be taken by the husband under Muslim law is ila, meaning thereby a constructive talaq. If husband given a condition that I will not have intercourse with you, and he continues to do so for over a 4 month, so it will be a ila kind of jalab, ila kind of divorce. Now friends, the third category is jihar, where a husband compares his wife with one of the relationship to whom the sexual intercourse is prohibited. Like he compares his wife with the mother, or he compares his wife with his sister. So this is called a jihar kind of talaq. Now again friends, wife can also take a divorce if the right to give the divorce by the husband has been delegated to the wife. That is called talaq-e-tahfeez. So if the husband has delegated his power to give the talaq to the wife, so wife can exercise this power of talaq and seek the divorce from the husband. Now the third category is the divorce by mutual consent or a mutual agreement. So here there are two kinds of divorce by the mutual agreement, that is khula and mubarrat. In khula, basically the wife prays to the husband after taking the mehar amount or after taking the certain other consideration, leave him from the bounds of the marriage. So give him the talaq. So it's a request, khula, to open the wife from the bondage of the marriage. Now the next category of divorce by the mutual agreement is mubarrat, in which it is exactly similar to the divorce by mutual consent into the Hindu's laws. So where both the parties mutually agreed that it's better to be live separate rather than together. So finally, by their mutual agreement, they can separate to each other. Now friends, the another category of divorce is under the Muslim law, that is judicial divorce. So it's a specific grounds for divorce has been given to the wife under the resolution of Muslim Marriage Act 1939. So friends, after discussing this Hindu's law of marriage and divorce, and after discussing Muslim laws of marriage and divorce, let us discuss the succession of or the inheritance of property into the Hindus and Muslim. So friends, either the Hindu or a Muslim, they both can divert their property either by making a specific will, that is called testamentary succession, or by, if they don't have make the any specific will during their lifetime, then the properties will go according to the intestamentary succession, the rules of intestamentary succession. Friends, if a Hindu dies after making a testamentary instrument for the succession of his property, that is called will, then the rules of Indian Succession Act will apply, and the property of a Hindu will be goes on to the future heirs as per the rules of Indian Succession Act and the specific will made by the Hindu. Friends, if a Muslim makes his will or a wasiyat, what we popularly call, then the it will be go as per the Shariat laws, and the one difference between the wasiyat of Muslim and a will of a Hindu is that there is a limitation to the Muslim that he cannot make his wasiyat of more than 1/3 of his old property. And again friends, even the property of a Muslim will devolve after deducting the certain expenses, that is of funeral charges or of any other dues already of the property. So friends, this was the one method of succession of the property, that is testamentary succession by the Hindu and Muslim. The another category is intestamentary succession, that is if a Hindu or a Muslim has died without making a will. Friends, in that case, for the Hindus, the rules has been prescribed under the Hindu Succession Act, and for Muslim there is a Shariat Act 1937, and according to the Shariat rules, the property will be passed on to the heirs of next generation. Friends, after this preliminary introduction of the law of succession, of testamentary succession, as well as the intestamentary succession of Hindus and Muslim, let us compare the concept of succession under the Hindus and the concept of succession under the Muslims. Friends, unlike the Hindu law, where the property is being classified for the purpose of succession as a self-acquired property and ancestral property, in Muslim law there is no such concept. It's considered to be a single property. Now, further, under Hindu law, a person, a birthright is created. The moment a person or a child borns, his right has been created into the existing ancestral property. But under Muslim law, the right is being created into any property after the death of the owner of the property. So, even if a son will, the interest of a son will be only created after the death of the father into the property. Now, the next important distinction between the Hindu law of succession and Muslim law of succession is, Muslim law of succession is, that the Hindu law follow the doctrine of representation, whereas the Muslim law does not follow the doctrine of representation. Doctrine of representation means that in case if any person has a legitimate right to inherit a particular property and he died, then on behalf of him, his legal representative or his legal heirs, as prescribed under Hindu Succession Act, they will be entitled to be inherit the property. So, they will be representing the legal heirs, but same is not case into the Muslim laws. So, these are the certain differences with regard to the Hindu laws of succession as well as Muslim laws of succession. Dear learners, we have seen the personal laws first, that is Hindu and Muslim law. We have seen the laws governing the marriage, divorce and succession to the Hindus, and the personal laws governing the marriage, divorce and succession to the Muslims. We have also seen the difference between the law of succession of Hindu on the one hand and the law of succession of the Muslims on another hand. Thank you very much.